हेलो व्यूअर्स, वेलकम टू टुडेज लेक्चर ऑन 8051 टाइमर काउंटर ऑपरेशंस। यू नो दैट फॉर एम्बेडेड एप्लीकेशंस देर आर न्यूमरस एप्लीकेशंस, फॉर एम्बेडेड सिस्टम्स देर आर न्यूमरस एप्लीकेशंस वेयर यू हैव टू जेनरेट प्रिसाइज क्लॉक्स ऑफ सम फ्रीक्वेंसीज, यू हैव टू काउंट इवेंट्स से नंबर ऑफ पर्सन्स एंटरिंग दी ए रूम और नंबर ऑफ पर्सन्स एंटरिंग दी क्रिकेट मैच टू वॉच क्रिकेट मैच और देर विल बी सिचुएशंस वेयर यू हैव टू जनरेट प्रिसाइज टाइम डिलेज। ऑल दीज ऑपरेशंस जेनरेटिंग क्लॉक्स, जेनरेटिंग प्रिसाइज टाइम डिलेज, काउंटिंग इवेंट्स, ऑल दीज थिंग्स कैन बी एफिशियंटली डन with the help of timer counters. In the context of 8085, we have discussed that 8253 timer counter section does that very efficiently. Today, in this lecture, we shall discuss how 8051 has provided built-in support for timer counter operations. But before that, let me very quickly go through the various alternatives. As you know, there are three alternatives. You can use software-based approach, purely software-based approach. In such a case, the processor is used to generate clocks, time delays, or count events, and processor remain busy for this purpose. However, this is very flexible. And second approach could be the hardware-based approach. Purely hardware-based approach, where we use some extra hardware to generate clock, generate delay, or count events. And however, this hardware-based approach is not very flexible. And although the software-based approach is very flexible, the processor remains busy during the entire period. When the processor is generating clocks or generating delays, it cannot do any other useful work. So processor is tied down to this mundane job of generating clock, generating delays, counting events, and so on. If that is the main application, there is no problem. We can use software-based approach. But there are numerous applications where the processor has to do many other operations along with generating clocks, generating time delays. So in such a case, we can use hardware-based approach, but it is not very flexible. And so the best alternative is to use combined approach. Combined hardware-software-based approach. We'll use some extra hardware and obviously some software. And together, it will perform generation of clock, counting delays, and so on. And we shall see that this approach is flexible, like software-based approach. At the same time, the processor is not tied down just for this job. And also, it can be implemented in a very efficient way by combining hardware and software. So we shall consider all the three approaches. First of all, very quickly, let us have a look at the software-based approach. How we can generate a pr we can write a program to generate square wave on a particular pin P1.0. So what you have to do, the 8051 has got say pin P1.0. On this pin, you have to generate some clock. So we have to write program for that. As usual, you can start with the flowchart. So start, then you have to set the pin P1.0. You have to set it to 1, And after that, we have to initialize a count register. So initialize count register. Some count register can be initialized. And after that, you will decrement the count register. So the operation is very simple. CR is decremented, CR minus 1. So, and after that, you will check whether the count value is 0 or not. CR is 0. So whenever it reaches 0, then if the if it is 0, answer is yes, answer is no, then we keep on looping. We go back to this point. On the other hand, if the answer is yes, we stop, because we can of course do some other operation like complement the bit. We can complement the say P 1.0, that is complemented, represented by the symbol P 1.0, and after that it goes back to this point. After you, it goes back to initialization point. So this is the program that has. This is the flowchart of the program, and let us write the program. It will be fairly simple. This can be realized by a single instruction. Set B P 1.0. Then these two can be combined together. I mean, initialization can be done with the help of a single instruction. Say you have to loop back here, so you have to come back here. So this is the label. Then we put move R6. We write some value, initialize it, say 255 decimal. Then these two operations, decrementing and jumping back, can be realized by a single instruction. So DJNZ R6, you are decrementing this counter and here. So we keep on decrementing it, and then you come here, you keep on looping till the value is 0, and once this is over, then you go back. So before returning back, you have to complement. So CPL complement, you have to complement this particular bit P1.0, and then S jump, you have to go back, S jump loop. So you see here, by this you can generate a clock, and the frequency can be decided by this value. However, the processor is remaining busy just for doing this operation. It cannot do anything else. So you see, this particular program, the software-based approach, is very flexible. You can generate any frequency by changing the count value, the control register, that count register value initialized by with which it is initialized, R6 is initialized. However, it has got the flexibility, but the processor remains busy. So this can be used only when the microcontroller is used just for this purpose. But there are many applications, as I told, where microcontroller will do many other job along with this. So in such a case, you cannot use software based approach. However, you can use some extra hardware like 555 timer, as we have discussed, for generating clock. And in that case, as you know, these registers RA, RB and C, these three decides the clock frequency. And for example, if you use, if you take the value, say RA equal to 6.8 kilo ohm, say RB is equal to 3.3 kilo ohm, and say C is equal to 0.01 microfarad, then you get frequency equal to about 10 kilohertz, 10.8 kilohertz. So you see, to get different frequencies, what you have to do, you have to change this value of RA, RB and C. One of the, you can change only C, or you can change RA or RB, and to get different frequencies. So you see, this is this hardware based approach is simple in the sense you require one extra hardware, but it is not at all flexible. To get different frequencies, you have to change this value of resistors or capacitors. So this approach is not very suitable for many applications where you have to generate frequencies or different frequencies. Moreover, these components RA, RB and C, these components are not very stable, not very accurate. With time their value changes, with temperature their value changes. So you cannot generate very precise clocks by using discrete components like choosing resistors and capacitors from by picking discrete resistors and capacitors. And with time these values will keep on changing. That's why this mode is not very suitable, this hardware based approach. You can also generate delay by using monostable operations. You can trigger, you can generate a Tegal signal. I have already discussed in detail the operation of 555 monostable multiplier. And you know that you can generate a, you can use a trigger, you can apply a trigger signal, and from that point you can get a delay. I mean the output 3 remains 1 for that duration, and after that time t it becomes 0, and the time is equal to 1.1 RC. So you can choose suitable value of resistor and capacitor which will be applied here, connected here, to get different delays. And as just like the Astable operation, here also the accuracy of the delay depends on the accuracy of the resistors and capacitors. And as I have told you, you don't get very accurate values of capacitors and resistors, and also their value changes with time, with temperature and so on. So you cannot generate precise delays by using hardware based approach. And that is where, that's why you, we come to the soft, the combined hardware and software based approach. And 8051 designers have provided built in support for that. What has been done in 8051? 2 16 bit timer counter sections have been provided. Timer counter sections have been provided. And obviously you require resistors, 2 16 bit resistors. These 2 16 bit resistors are provided by using 4 8 bit resistors, D0, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6, D7. So this is one resistor, say let me call it timer lower order byte timer 0. So this is the lower order byte of timer 0. And this is referred to as TL0. This is the mnemonic that is being used for this particular resistor, and it can be accessed as an 8-bit resistor. And similarly, you will use another resistor D8 to D15, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So D15. So this is another resistor, and this is your TH0. That means the timer 0 higher order byte. And similarly you have two more resistors, TL1 and TH1. So these four resistors can be accessed as 8-bit general purpose, special purpose resistor. So these are part of the special purpose resistors provided by 8051, and you can initialize them with value by using instruction like this, move say TL0, and you can initialize with some value say F8H. So this 8 bit resistor can be initialized with this value, and higher order byte also can be initialized in a similar manner. So you can access them as 4 8 bit resistors. And these are their mnemonics, TL0, TH0, TL1 and TH1. So apart from these 16-bit, two 16-bit resistors available as 4 8-bit resistors, it is also provided with two special purpose resistors like TCON, which is essentially timer control resistor. Timer control resistors, with the help of which you can configure the timer for different operations and perform various control operations. And also you have got TMOD register. TMOD and TCON, these are the two timer control and timer mode control registers, with the help of which you can control the operation of these two timer counter sections. So we shall discuss in detail how these two registers are used to control the operation of these two 16-bit timer counter sections. So let us start with the TCON register, which is a special function register, and as you can see here, it is a 8-bit register starting with 0 to 7. And it has got 8 bits, out of which the first 4 bits TF1, TR1, TF0 and TR0, these are used for timer control. Although this is part of the timer control register, the other 4 bits IE1, IT1, IE0 and IT0, these 4 bits are used for interrupt control. So we can say that TCON is a dual purpose register. Part of the bits, the higher order 4 bits are used for timer control, and lower order 4 bits are used for the interrupt control. Let us briefly discuss the function of these various bits. So TF1 is a timer 1 overflow. This is a timer 1 overflow flag bit. As we have seen, you have got two 16-bit register. They will be initialized with some values by using instruction like this. And after you initialize them and then enable the counting operation, we shall discuss how the enabling can be done, then it will start counting up. In the context of 8253, we have seen the counter operates in as down counter, and terminal count is reached whenever you get all zero. Here it is different. Here the counters operate as up counter. So after the count value reaches FFFF, then it will become 0000. That means as the counter rolls over from FFFF to 0000, then the timer flag bit will become 1. So TF will become 1. Will become 1 whenever this situation occurs, and it will reset. It can be resetted either by software means or whenever that TF bit, if it is 1, will become 0 whenever you jump to that interrupt service subroutine corresponding to this timer 1, that means jump to 001B address. So this particular flag bit will be set whenever there is a rollover of the counter from all 1 to all 0, and either it can be resetted by software by using that bit reset operation, or that means you can reset it that RST TCON dot 7, then this will be resetted. Or whenever you jump to that interrupt service subroutine, automatically it will be resetted to 0. So you see, this is the operation of the timer 1 overflow. Then you have got TR1. TR1 flag bit is timer run control bit, timer 1 run control bit. That means the counting operation can be controlled by software. You can enable and disable counting with the help of this bit TR0. Whenever this bit is 1, counting is enabled. Count enable. And whenever this bit is 0, then it disables count. Count disable. So these counters that I have shown, these two counters can be enabled or disabled. This particular bit can be used for enabling or disabling the counter 1. Similarly, you have the TF0, the corresponding overflow bit for timer 0. So this is your timer 0 overflow flag bit. And it operates in the same way. However, in this case, the interrupt service subroutine address is 0000BH. This is the interrupt service subroutine address. That means whenever if the processor jumps to this address, this flag bit will be resetted. Otherwise, the function is same as this timer 1 overflow flag bit. Similarly, TR0 is the timer run control bit, timer 0 run control bit. That means that enabling and disabling of the counter section 0 is performed with the help of this particular bit. In the same way, if it is 1, that counter 0 is enabled for counting, or if it is 0, counter 0 is disabled for counting. Now, although these 4 bits are not relevant in the context of timer operations, very quickly let me discuss about them. So this IE1 is external interrupt 1, external interrupt 1, interrupt 1, edge flag. That means whenever there is a high to low edge coming on this external interrupt input, this flag bit will be set. That means you have got external interrupt input IT1, and on that, whenever this edge comes, this particular flag bit will be set, and it will be set when processor jumps to the corresponding interrupt service subroutine, that is at 0013 address. This is the interrupt service subroutine. So it will be reset by this. Of course, it can be reset by software means as well. Then you have got IT1, which is external interrupt 1, external interrupt 1, interrupt 1 edge flag. This is your interrupt 1, IT, this is your IT0, IT1, this is your external interrupt 1, signal type control bit. Signal type control bit. What it does, it defines whether an edge, high to low edge, or a low level will be used to interrupt as an interrupt signal for external interrupt 1. So it defines whether an edge type of high to low edge or a low level will be used for interrupting the processor through external interrupt 1. Similarly, you have got IE0. This is the this performs the same operation as external interrupt 0 flag bit. So here it is external interrupt 0 flag bit, edge flag bit. So here also the operation is same. At whenever the external interrupt 0 line goes to high to low, this flag bit is set, and it can be resetted when it jumps to interrupt service subroutine 0003H. This is the vector address for this external interrupt 0. Similarly, you have got another bit, IT0. This is your external interrupt. Interrupt 0 signal type control bit. So we can see here these are the operations of different flag bits of that TCON special function register, timer control special function register. Let us see the operation of timer mode control special function registers. As you can see here also you have got 8 bits. However, the lower order 4 bit is used for timer 0, and the higher order 4 bit is used for timer 1. And you have got 4 bits for each of these timer operation to control the operation of each of the timers. The first let me discuss about the M0 and M1. So whenever M1 and M0, they have got 4 combinations 00, 01, 10 and 11. So with the help of these 4 bits, the mode of operation of these timers is decided. So whenever these 2 bits or these 2 bits are 00, either timer 0 or timer 1 will operate in mode 0. And whenever this is 01, then it is mode 1. Whenever it is 10, mode 2. Whenever it is 11, mode 3. That means both timer 0 and timer 1 can be operated in 4 different modes. I shall discuss in detail the function of these 4 different modes one after the other. But before that, let me discuss the operation of these 2 bits, gate and CT bar. The CT bar, count timer bar, this signal, this particular flag bit is used to define the source of input pulse. Whenever this bit is 1, then the source is comes from external source, and whenever this bit is 0, then the source is internal, as I shall explain with the help of a diagram. Similarly, gate is used to define whether the activation, that means the enabling and disabling of count operation, whether it has to be by software means or by hardware means, that is decided by gate. So the function of these 2 bits can be best explained with the help of this timer counter control logic. First of all, let's see what are the function of this bit CT bar. As you can see here, there is a switch here. This goes to the counter. It is going to counter, one of the 2 timer counter section it goes. Now the pulse can come either from internal source. Whenever C by T bar is equal to 0, that means it is acting as a timer mode. On the other hand, whenever CT bar is equal to 1, here it is count mode. So here you can see, whenever CT bar is equal to 0, the clock is coming by dividing the oscillator clock frequency by 12. So by dividing the oscillator clock frequency, you get a clock here. So here you see the clock is divided by 12, and as you know, the number of clock cycles per machine cycle is also 12. So essentially, in the timer mode, the counter is counting the number of machine cycles. So counting is done, and whenever the clock frequency is 12 megahertz, suppose if OSC is 12 megahertz, then this will be 1 megahertz. So this will go here, and whenever it is operating in counter mode, the input is coming from some external source. As you have seen, that T1 or T0 inputs are provided in the timer counter section, and whenever this line is 1, pulse which goes to the counter comes from this input pin from external source. So you can this particular mode can be used for external event counter. Now that to enable or disabling of count by software and hardware means this particular circuit is used. Whenever this gate is zero, then this is one and this is always one. And when this gate is zero, then the enabling and disabling of the operation can be done by that TR0 or TR1 flag bit. We have seen there is a TR0 and TR1 flag bit here, TR0 and TR1 flag bit. By setting and resetting these two bits, you can enable counting or disable counting whenever this gate bit is reset to zero. That means for software control, you have to make this bit zero of the timer mode operation, and then by using this bit or this bit, you can do the software control. On the other hand, whenever this gate is one, then this is zero. Whenever gate is one, then this is zero. In such a case, the external, this signal will be controlled, that output will be controlled by this interrupt inputs, INT 1, 0 and INT 1 input line. That means that external by applying suitable signals on the interrupt inputs, INT 1 or INT 0, you can enable counting or disable counting in this mode. That means when the gate bit is set to 1, that control operation is done by hardware rather than by software. So we have seen that 8251 has kept provision for controlling the counter, enabling and disabling of the counter by software as well as by hardware means. Now let us see mode 0 and mode 1 operation of the timer counter section. I am discussing them together because they are more or less, their operation is more or less same. We have discussed about the source of pulse input, and we have seen that in different situations it will come either from internal source or from external source. So this is the input to counter is drawn here. So this is the pulse. So in mode 0, we use as a divide by 13 counter. So TL is essentially a 5 bit counter, and this output goes to THX and TLX. It can be TL0 or TH0, both timer 0 and timer 1 operate in the same manner. This is 8 bit, TH0 is 8 bit, and this output goes to that flag bit, so TFX. And whenever this TFX flag bit is set, the interrupt can be generated. So this goes to interrupt line. So this is the operation in mode 0. So in mode 0, this acts as a divide by 2 to the power 13, or you can say 13 bit divider, or you can say you are pre-scaling by 32. Pre-scaling by 32 and then divide by 8 bit. So essentially you are using 13 bit counter, and whenever there is a rollover from all 1 to all 0, then this flag bit is set and interrupt can be generated both for timer 0 and timer 1. On the other hand, in case of mode 1, the clock will come from the same source, as I have told, from here, either from internal source or from external source, and performing the usual control operations. However, in this case, this TLX is 8 bit counter, and TLH is also 8 bit counter. TLH is also 8 bit counter. And this goes to that TFX. So here you can say TLX, sorry, this will be THX. TLX, THX, TFX, and this goes to interrupt. And this is your mode 1. So here you can see it is essentially a 16-bit counter. So basic difference between mode 0 and mode 1 is, in mode 0 it is 13-bit counter, in mode 1 it is 16-bit counter. And both can be operated in timer mode or in count mode by choosing this particular flag bit. And also you can perform the control operation by using get control and TR0 and TR1 control. Now let us consider the mode 2 operation. Mode 2 operation is very interesting. What is done here in this particular mode, the counters can be used as a 8-bit counter. So in this case, the pulse is coming, pulse input is coming, pulse input from the usual source, as I have shown here earlier, and this goes to the lower order 8-bit of the counter. That means it goes to TLX, and this output goes to TFX, that overflow flag bit, whenever the rollover takes place from all 1 to all 0, and this goes to interrupt. However, the interesting thing in this case is the higher order 8 bit THX is loaded with some value, and this value, it gets preloaded, gets loaded here. Here is your control. That means as the rollover takes place from all 1 to all 0, the 8 bit from the higher order counter bit, that means TH1 or TH0, it is loaded into TL1 or TL0. That means this mode is known as 8 bit auto load counter operation. In the previous two cases, once the counting operation is done and they become all 1 or all 0, if you want to start afresh, you have to re-initialize them with some value. But in this case, you are performing the initialization automatically. So in this auto load mode, the initialization of the lower order bit counter takes place by taking value from the higher order bit counter. That means you have to initialize the higher order 8 bit TH1 or TH0 with some value, and then each time whenever the counting starts, that data is loaded from higher order 8 bit to the lower order 8 bit, both for counter 0 and counter 1. And similarly, whenever that rollover takes place from all 0 to all 1, the reloading takes place. So this is very useful in repetitive applications, and later on we shall see this can be used for baud rate generation in your whenever you perform serial data transfer. So this is your mode 2 operation of the timer. Now let us consider the operation of mode 3. In mode 3, you can have two separate 8-bit counters from timer 0. How? This is the pulse input. Coming from the same source, and it goes to lower order 8 bit TLX 8 bit, and this goes to that TFX, that overflow flag bit, whenever all 0 to all 1 takes place, and this goes to INT. INT means interrupt for timer 0. Oh, here it will be, sorry, it will be 0. This is 0 and INT, interrupt for timer 0. and this is for the lower order 8 bit. You get a 8 bit timer counter in this case, and you can have another 8 bit timer counter. However, the clock can be that F oscillator by 12 internal clock, and that can be enabled or disabled with the help of that TR1 bit of that timer counter register, and this will go to higher order 8 bit. So TH0, and this is also 8 bit, and this however we have already used up that TF0. So in this case this goes to TF1, and this goes to interrupt. Interrupt of timer 1. One thing you must notice here, although this corresponds to timer 0 operation, we have used up the TR1 bit and TF1 bit of timer 1. That means the timer 1 cannot be used in its usual operation. That's why the timer 0 is operated in mode 3 only when you require two separate counters, and also the timer 1 does not require TF1 and TR1 flag bit. And normally timer 1 can be used in such application. Timer 1 can be used in such a case, can be used to generate baud rate in mode 2 auto load mode. So whenever you use timer 1 in mode 2 auto load mode, then however these bits are not necessary for timer 1. So you can use them for timer 0, and you have two separate counters. So essentially you are able to get three separate counters, and both all of them are 8 bit, and timer 1 is used for in auto load mode, and timer 0 can be used in any one of the three modes. And in that case, as you can see here, you get two separate 8 bit timer counters. So we have discussed the use of the timer counter sections, both timer 0 and timer 1, in four different modes. Let us discuss some applications of these timer counter section. Here we have taken up an example to generate a square wave on pin 1.0 using timer 0 to generate delay. You may recall that we have discussed how the delay can be generated by software means. In this case, here instead of generating the delay by software means, we have used it to generate delay by using the timer 0. Let us see how we have done. This particular instruction actually sets the mode of operation, of the timer, and this particular instruction loads the timer 0 with the initial values. These are the values, initialization. This is also initialization, initializes the lower order 8 bit and higher order 8 bit with these values 0EEH and 0FFH. Then it makes the pin P1.0, complements the pin, whatever was the earlier value, that is complemented. Then it generates a delay. And whenever it goes to the delay routine, it sets the flag bit TR0 so that the counting is enabled. As we have seen, that counting has to be enabled only by setting this bit TR0. And it keep on looping until this flag bit TF0 is 1. So here you keep on looping, keeps on generating the delay till the flag bit is 0. So this is the delay routine. this part, and then after it comes out of that, you clear the TR0 bit, disabling counting. You have to clear the flag bit to make it ready for the next operation. Ready for next operation. And then you return. And this you perform in this way. So in this case also you will get the square wave on port 1.0, and let us see what will be the frequency of that clock. In this case, so what will be the clock frequency that you will get? You see, this is in the loop, the machine cycles is 2, this will also require 2 machine cycles, this will require 1 machine cycle, this will require 2 machine cycle, this will require 2 machine cycle, and these instructions also will require 1 machine cycle. This delay routine you are subtracting from FF, FE, so it will perform 17 loops, so 17 clock cycles. Then this will require 1 clock cycle, this will require 1 clock cycle, this will require 1 cycle, clock cycle. Total time required is 30 clock cycles, the number of machine cycles. And the timer period T is equal to 2 into 30 into that 1 machine cycle time period, 1085. Millisecond, microsecond, sorry, sir. This is your microsecond. Assuming that the F oscillation frequency is 11.059 megahertz. Assuming this, this will be the time period, and you can calculate it and find out the clock frequency. So, F will be just 1 by T. So, here we have used the timer 0 to generate delay. However, we have not used it in the interrupt mode. Here we have used it by checking that flag bit TF0 and checking it until it becomes 1. So this is again a software approach, you can some kind of asynchronous approach. You can use also interrupt driven mode, as it is explained in this particular example. And the advantage of interrupt driven mode is that you can keep on doing operation, certain operations, and at the same time you can also generate a delay. That means clock can be generated on a pin, at the same time you can do some other operations, and this is being explained in this example. Here you are essentially keeping some space for the for some. This is the interrupt service subroutine. This is the ISR, interrupt service subroutine, for timer. And this is the main routine. So in the main routine, you are initializing the mode control of the timer in mode 2. 8-bit operation and so on, and then you are loading the TH0 by some initializing the timer 8-bit, higher order 8-bit, and as you know, it will be loaded in the lower order 8-bit as you generate the delay. Then you are enabling the interrupt with the help of this enable interrupt. And you are setting this bit to initiate count operation, and after that you are reading some value from port A, maybe some data you are reading from port 1, and then you are transferring it to port B. So continuously you are reading some data from port 1, sending it to port 0, and looping it. But whenever that all 0 to all 1 overflow occurs, it will jump to interrupt service subroutine, and it will keep on changing the port 2.0. So you will get a clock on port 2.0. At the same time, the processor will keep on doing this operation, reading some data from port 1 and load it into port 0. So you can see, you can perform two simultaneous operations with the help of this particular program. As you can see here, we have used the interrupt mode of timer timer so that the timer 0, so that the processor can do something else. So processor is not tied down only for generating the delay in this case or checking the status of the timer. So this is the advantage. And another, so far we have discussed the operation of the timer as a timer mode, timer counter operation. You can also perform the use it for event count. For example, in this application, we have used the timer counter for counting the number of events that is taking place on port 3.5. That means you are it is sensing the clocks here. Question may be, question will arise, what is the maximum rate at which the sensing can be done? It has been found that each high and low has to be for at least one machine cycle. That means that decides the maximum external frequency that can be received on this or the rate of occurrence of the external event has to be, maximum rate of external event is f oscillation by 24. If it is say 12 megahertz clock, then maximum external frequency that you can receive is 500 kilohertz. So you have to keep that in mind. So the counting of external event is restricted up to 500 kilohertz. That is decided by the clock frequency. So here is the program for that particular operation. You are this particular instruction is setting the mode of operation. Timer 1 is used in mode 2, and you are loading that higher order 8 bit by 0, then setting that pin P3.5 as input port so that you can receive the clock, and you are setting that B TR1, that timer 1 beat is being set to 1 so that the counting operation starts, and then you are loading this value goes to TL1, you are loading it to A and you are transferring to the port 1. That means that data is displayed now on LED, and then you are keeping on looping until it becomes that there is an overflow on bit, flag bit sets to 1, and then you go back. So you keep on looping in this way, and whenever this is over, you come back. Until that is 1, you keep on looping, and whenever there is an overflow, you come out, then it clears the TR1 bit, clears TF1 bit, and it goes back again. So here you see this particular mode, the counter can be used for counting external events like number of persons entering a particular room, maybe in a conference you want to find out how many persons have entered a room, or in a cricket match how many spectators enter to watch the match on that particular date. This type of thing can be done in this counter mode. So, friends, we can conclude by saying that the 80551 has been provided with two built-in 16-bit timer counter sections with four different modes of operations, which can be used in numerous applications. And we have discussed all these things in this lecture. Thank you.